The first German locomotive, the Adler, runs from Nuremberg to Fürth. While a French opéra comique celebrates the good old stagecoach.
In Paris, a young man from Germany is studying industry and commerce, now a progressive subject in France. He writes in his diary,
"For the first time, I was faced with the magnificent connections that Paris maintains at home and abroad. I viewed the blossoming of an unfettered and lively industry, the roads on which trade goes out to far-off places, the image of immense traffic that allows products to flow to and fro between suppliers and purchasers. I realized the possibility of structuring conditions at home in quite a different way."
Inspired by these impressions in Paris, he sends instructions home to Stein to manufacture a special new product, later famous as polygrades.
Astonishing how keen and determined this young man's ideas were.
All the more astounding when one remembers that he was just 22 at the time.
His name? Lothar Faber. ...1839 is an important year in the history of the company. Lothar Faber, the fourth of his dynasty, takes over the management.
"I realized the possibility of structuring conditions at home in quite a different way."
And that is just what he does.
Bit by bit, he places the family business on a new industrial basis. He introduces machinery so as to be able to produce in quantity.
He becomes the first German pencil manufacturer to set new standards.
Quality.
An international outlook.
And a social responsibility towards his employees and others he has dealings with.
Quality. Above all, he sees that as the key to success. He employs new production methods to make pens and pencils of an unprecedented quality.
Lothar Faber invents the hexagonal pencil, later familiar all over the world.
And he turns what up to now were anonymous writing implements into brand name articles. From 1840, he marks all his products with the name A.W. Faber.
An expression of pride in the quality he's achieved? Certainly that's part of it.
He wants his company to get ahead. He wants to set himself apart from the traders selling no-name products. Lothar Faber is equally skilled in technical and business matters. With this combination of talents, he steers a successful course for his company.
He wants to conquer the world markets. So, being a man of action, he sets off to see those markets.
All over Germany, to Austria, France, Belgium and Holland, England, Italy, Switzerland, and even to Russia.
In all the important cities, he makes business contacts and sets up several sales offices, including, of course, in the capital, Berlin. This is the once famous Faber House.
Quality.
An international outlook.
And Lothar doesn't neglect a further point in his recipe for success. A wide variety of products.
100 years after the company was founded, His catalogue is over 100 pages long and printed using the best lithographic process.
He offers everything one needs for writing and drawing.
But wait, before we get to 1861, Lothar still has to fulfill some of the goals he set himself.
Even forgetting the California Gold Rush, Lothar Faber is fascinated by the new world across the Atlantic. He sees the USA as a giant market with enormous potential.
He founds his first foreign subsidiary in New York. That was in 1849. And today, A.W. Faber is the oldest surviving trademark in the USA.
Over the years, more subsidiaries follow in important cities: Vienna, London, St. Petersburg.
But for Lothar, the most important city is Paris, which he sees as the center of world trade. In 1855, he opens a shop there, on the grandest square in all Paris.
It's the year of the second great exhibition.
The Eiffel Tower hasn't yet been built, but there's still plenty to attract the crowds. And they can admire one of the first posters advertising brand name goods.
From now on, Faber products are a regular feature at national and international exhibitions.
And just as regularly, they gain medals and commendations.
1855.
In the East, Alexander II is crowned Tsar of Russia. He later abolishes serfdom.
In the West, the Treaty of Paris marks the end of the Crimean War in 1856.
And several famous people are born.
A red-haired boy who will later sport a long beard and gain a reputation for his caustic remarks, George Bernard Shaw.
Another Irishman, Oscar Wilde.
And in Austria, Sigmund Freud.
What about Germany?
Richard Wagner's opera Lohengrin receives its first performance in Weimar.
Franz Liszt is acclaimed for his Hungarian Rhapsodies.
And Josef Mayr publishes the first edition of his encyclopedic dictionary. Let's look up the word graphite. Graphite, or plumbago, a crystalline form of carbon consisting of hexagonal sheets of atoms. An opaque solid with a grey metallic luster and a soft, greasy feel. When mixed with clay, it is used in pencils, black lead.
Aha! That explains it! Our lead pencil should really be a graphite pencil, because that's what it's made of.
Not lead at all. The confusion came about because the two substances look similar.
But the name stuck, incorrect though it was, and we can hardly change it now.
So, back to our story. It's about a pencil manufacturer who is on the lookout for a source of the best graphite. And in his search, he takes an unusual step.
He knows where a raw material is to be found that they call black gold. Far beyond the Ural Mountains, near Irkutsk, he acquires a graphite mine. Of course, Lothar has to take into account the enormous distances and the resulting high cost of transport.
But his blossoming company now has the best quality graphite that has ever been available. If we try to summarize how Lothar Faber thought and acted, we can only say that he was an unusual businessman.
Well, in fact, everything about him was unusual. He was unusually successful.
And he had a strong social awareness, most unusual for his time. In 1844, he set up one of the first company health schemes. It's still in existence.
In 1849, there followed a savings bank for his workers.
And in 1851, one of the first kindergartens in Germany.
The news spreads far and wide. Napoleon III, the new French emperor, sends a delegation to study most carefully the social system at the Faber factory. For example, the apartments built for the workers. These pictures date from 1861.
That year, the village of Stein also gets a new church, with a generous donation by Lothar Faber.
What's so special about 1861?
Of course, in 1861, the business has been going for 100 years. It's now a familiar name, its products sold all over the world.
To mark the centenary, Lothar founds a new factory to make writing slates at Geroldsgrün in North Bavaria and employing 300 people.
Nowadays, it has modern production lines for writing implements and cosmetic articles.
100 years of A.W. Faber. For Lothar, that's good reason and incentive to achieve even more. He continues to be unusually active, beyond the interests of his company alone.
Together with Theodor Kramer Klett, he founds the Bavarian Trades Association. That's in 1871.
In the same year, he's a joint founder of the Union Bank in Nuremberg.
And in 1884, the Nuremberg Life Assurance Company, later the successful Nürnberger Insurance Group.
Lothar also had an unusual influence on public life. As a manufacturer, he created one of the first brand name articles. Later, he helped lay the foundations of Germany's first trademark law.
Following his petition to the Imperial Council, a law came into force in 1875 to protect the rights of trademarks and brand names.
But Lothar is thinking on a much larger scale. He sees the link between economic and political stability.
In 1878, he writes a pamphlet about the future development of Europe. He suggests setting up a European Parliament. Yes, in 1878. Only such a parliament, he says, could assure law and order throughout Europe and prevent aggressive breaches of territorial rights.
The unusual life of Lothar Faber receives unusual recognition. He is ennobled by King Maximilian II of Bavaria for his services to industry and his good works, and a few years later, raised to the hereditary peerage. Prince Regent Luitpold nominates him a hereditary councillor to the Bavarian crown after he had already been made an imperial councillor in 1856.
If we wish to honour the life's work of Lothar von Faber, we could hardly do better than take his own words.
From the beginning, I strove to rise to the highest position by producing the best that could be made in the whole world. The popularity of the A.W. Faber pencils is demonstrated by quotations from prominent people of the day. For example, Wilhelm Busch. In his picture book, Blot the Illustrator, we find the verse,
"Meanwhile Kuno does contrive to wield a Faber number 5, the grumbling Hinterstich to poke with many a somewhat painful stroke."
Again and again, poets and thinkers, authors, artists, and politicians declare their love of the pencil. For example, Bismarck, the American President Ulysses Grant, Ephraim Kishon, Alexander Solzhenitsyn, Joseph Beuys, Heinrich Böll, and even the great Goethe himself. His hymn of praise is almost rapturous.
"In just this frame of mind, I far rather reached for the pencil, which more willingly produced its strokes. For it had more than once occurred that the rasping and spluttering of the quill awoke me from the poet's trance, distracted me, and stifled some minor work at its birth."
Around 1880, Vincent van Gogh wrote to a friend and fellow artist, "I meant to tell you about a kind of pencil I found made by Faber. They're coloured dark green on the outside, produce a capital black, and are most agreeable for large studies."